Welcome to another evening of Bible study. I hope and anticipate that many of you were able to tune in on Sunday evening when we began this series looking at the mark of the beast. And so we won't have to do too much recapping, but I will start off with we're going back as far as the second question. And the second question, which we have not finished, by the way, is the mark of the beast a literal mark or is it some kind of technology? We were answering that from scripture, but we have not finished it yet. So we were making sure that we are steady on that because there are so many people going around claiming all kinds of things about the mark of the beast and stating that it is this. From one technology to the next, from one year to the next, or one decade to the next, they are claiming all kinds of things being the mark of the beast and forget to simply just read the scripture of Revelation. So we are going to go back and recap what we have learned so far and seek to finish that passage that we started in Revelation chapter 13. And remember, at any time, if you have questions, comments, feel free to chime in. So we were looking at this question. Is the mark of the beast a literal mark or some kind of modern technology? And we began looking at a passage, which is Revelation 13. And if you're able to turn to Revelation 13, you can do so. And by the way, my speech starts to slow down because of poor internet or you lose me, please let me know. Or sometimes the volume goes down or I freeze up. Please let me know so that I can repeat what was said. All right, guys. So it's good to also make sure that you guys are with me occasionally as well. All right. So we read Revelation 13 verses 16 to 18, and then we started to explore verse 16, first of all. Hopefully we'll get to verse 17 and 18 tonight in details. But on verse 16, reading it, it says, "He, the Antichrist, makes all persons, low and high, rich and poor, free persons and slaves, to have a mark put upon their right hands or upon their foreheads." All right? And so we started by defining what a mark is and what the word mark means from the Greek. It's karagma, and the word mark there that is used is a scratch or etching or a stamp as a badge of servitude or some kind of engraving. And so the word that is used, mark, rendered mark, occurs 9 times in the New Testament, and 8 times out of the 9 times Revelation is the user of it. It is only used one other time in the New Testament, which is Acts 17, verse 29, where it is also rendered graven. In other words, every time it is used in the New Testament, that word karagma, all right, even though the Acts 17 uses the English word graven and the Revelation passage uses the word mark in English, it means the same word, it's the same karagma. All of them are etchings. And in Acts 17, when it is used, it is like an etching for that persons would engrave to their false gods. All right. So the word mark everywhere that is used is pertaining to something that is some kind of etching or stamp or something. It's something that is visible. All right. Already, just the definition alone should tell you what the answer is when we talk about, is the mark a literal mark? Yes, it is a literal mark. It is not any kind of special technology hidden. It is a mark, and the definition of the word describes it. The word properly means something graven or sculptured, all right? So the Greek word implies an animal brand. You know, back in the days, some people actually still brand their animals. They might have used different kind of technologies over the years, but some people still brand their animals to say who the animals belong to. But the idea is it's belonging, all right? It's identification, all right? Or the Greek word also implies an impression that is made by a stamp, like a seal on a government document, and that can be like a permanent ink, all right? Or it is an engraving like a tattoo. Any one of these methods is applied to the skin, all right? And so the word, when it is used, your mark of the beast, we have no reason to go anywhere else in our definition, nowhere else to go, no reason to go anywhere else in our understanding of what the mark of the beast is, meaning it is going to be and has to be visible based on what the definition of the word mark here is. Because one thing is for certain, the Antichrist, powered by the devil, is going to want to put his stamp on the people who would have chosen to serve him and to worship him. And he wants them to be known. And so that's why we don't have to wonder about any kind of hidden secret thing. When the time comes for the Antichrist to reveal himself and people take the mark, it's not going to be a hidden thing. It's going to be, people are literally going to be marked. We can take that literally because the word itself is literal. All right? And so that's what we learned. All right? But it is said, we're recapping still, and for anyone just joining us and you never got the Sunday night teaching, we are letting you know that the position is quite clear in the Bible. It says that it is either going to be at one or two places, either on the right hand or the forehead. Never said the foot, never said the left hand, never said the belly, never said the chest. And as I said to you, this has to happen this way because this is prophecy. So therefore, please understand that this is not going to change. It must happen the way the scripture says it. You remember what John saw? He saw a glimpse of the future. And the future has not occurred yet in this part, but the future is clear according to John's revelation that the people who choose the mark of the beast are going to either have it on their right hand or their forehead. All right, notice it never said their shoulder, you know, their arm, but the hand itself, the hand itself. All right. And so a mark in these places was used to denote some kind of stamp or ID in the case of a servant on whose hand this name of the master was impressed, or a soldier on whom a mark was impressed, denoting the army or group to which he belonged. It was no uncommon thing to mark slaves or soldiers in this way, and the design was either to denote ownership or rank, or to prevent them from escaping undetected. And so when the Antichrist is going to mark the people who decide to serve him, he is going to mark them for life and mark them in one of two public places that if anybody is moving about, unless they decide to, the forehead one is easy to see, but if they put something over it, but the idea is you can easily well remove whatever covering if somebody is trying to hide it, to deceive you. Whether if they have on a tam and it covers the forehead, you can remove it and you look. Well, we are not going to be here, but I'm just telling you, if people try to hide it, it is etched in their skin and they will not be able to escape that, all right? So the mark will be indelibly inscribed either on the right hand or the forehead of the people to show that they who bear it pledge allegiance to the Antichrist and are subject to his authority as a slave is to his master or a soldier to his commander. There will be a mark of distinction, something which would designate the entire certainty. Those persons who belong to the Antichrist, that's the mark of distinction. And I looked at some verses that we looked at the verses that were below to show you the consistency of that, that it was mentioned further in different passages in chapter 14 and chapter 20. Those who took the mark and it said it was on their hand and so forth. So the consistency still holds true that there are going to be people who accept the mark of the beast and it is either going to be on their right hand or their forehead. Any questions, any comments before we move on? Because we're still going to look on verse 17, which helps to bring out some more things. Any questions or comments before we move on? All right. None whatsoever. All right. So let's keep going. Now, I did say to you, for those who tuned in on Sunday evening, that the saints of God have a mark too. So why did I bring this up? And I just thought that this is very important for us to understand. The idea of a mark is not unique and it is not exclusive to Satan and the Antichrist. Yeah. So that is why you don't have to wonder if this mark of the beast is going to be a literal mark, because the saints of God have a literal mark too. So in a heart, accept when you realize that both sides. Some of you know the passages, some of you don't know, your mindset yourself, but why bring the evidence, Pastor? Yeah. So why am I bringing this up for us to understand that we're all going to be marked, so to speak, you know, who is for God and who is for the devil. And so it is not hard to understand that there's a mark that will take place. All right. So here we go. So the saints of God have a mark too. But the first passage I'm going to bring up is one where this happened. This is not future, but this happened in the past, where God actually marked in the foreheads of some people in Jerusalem, a holy remnant in Jerusalem. Before I look at the Ezekiel passage and before I put it on the screen, so to speak, the reference, what was happening there was that God was going to judge Jerusalem, the people there in Jerusalem at that particular time. He was going to rain down judgment on them. He was going to just simply destroy the unholy people, judge them, so to speak. But then, because not all of them were unholy and wicked, he wanted to make sure that the wrong people, the right people were judged, meaning, and that is not everybody. So he wanted to make sure that there was a remnant there, those who were holy and following God, that they would escape that judgment. They would be distinct. And so what God decided to do was put a mark on these people. And the mark was on their forehead. And the passage is there, Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 4. It is not, the wording of the passage is not on the screen, but I have it in my Bible. And if you want to follow along, you can. And I'll just jump to verse 4. Ezekiel 9, verse 4 says, "And the Lord said unto him, Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And to the others, he said in my hearing, Go ye after him through the city and smite them. Let not your eyes spear, neither have ye pity." So God was going to rain down judgment, as I said. And in order to preserve those who did not deserve this kind of punishment, he said, put a mark on their, guess where? Their foreheads. So when you see that the Antichrist is going to mark the people on their forehead or on their hand, it is nothing new. In fact, a lot of people talk about mark of the beast and mark in forehead and even try to go so far as to mysticize it and, you know, spiritualize it. When this thing was happening from earlier days, it was happening from Old Testament. It was the idea of identifying who is who. And so it happened to a holy remnant in Jerusalem. He says, put a mark on their foreheads. And we're not talking about the mark of the beast, you know. Don't get me wrong. Anybody who's just joining us, I don't want you to misunderstand me. I am not saying that he's putting a mark of the beast on their head. But what am I saying? I'm saying that this idea of marking is nothing new. And the idea of marking people is nothing new, and it is not exclusive to the people of the devil and the Antichrist either. God said, put a mark on their forehead so that you can know who is who. Because he's sending out people. He's sending out people to, you know, to destroy, to punish. They don't want to destroy the wrong people. They don't want to destroy the good with the bad. So the marking was used to do so. I don't know what kind of mark, it never tell us, but it was a mark nevertheless of identification. And this one thing I want to then also say right here and now is that the word mark here that is used in the Hebrew means the same as the Greek word charagma, meaning something that is etched or sculptured, something that is engraved on the person's forehead. So it means the same thing in Hebrew and in Greek, something that is visible. It had to be visible for the people to see. So if, for instance, they decide to put a cross, I'm not saying that was a cross, but just using that as an example, cross on their forehead, the people who are doing the punishing would just simply pass by. All right? So then this is supposed to be common knowledge to all of you. The 144,000 Jews, which will be chosen in the future, they have not taken effect yet. This is still end time stuff now, right? God is going to mark them. And some of you are supposed to know this already. All right. So the scriptures are there. I will just quickly, I'm closer to Revelation as well. So I'll just quickly read them out. Revelation 7 verse 3 says, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. Now, an interesting thing here is you, the word sealed. No, yes, the question some of you may have in your head. So, Pastor, is that the same karagma, the Greek word? No, because I told you that the Greek word is used eight times in Revelation. This is not the place where it is used. But guess what the word seal means? The word seal there used in the Greek is not karagma, but it still means to mark, to etch, to engrave, interestingly. But the idea is that they're using different terms to define or to describe the same thing. The idea of a seal, the idea of a mark, the idea of engraving, all of it is going to be visible. All right, so and notice where it is, the foreheads. So let me just interject this. When the Antichrist and the devil is going to be having this mark of the beast thing going on, you realize it wasn't there. Is the devil a mimic God, you know? God was already marking his people and marking those who are holy, marking those who are set aside. Is the devil just trying to mimic God? That's why I tell you that the devil has all been trying to mimic God in different ways. And one of them is that God is a Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The devil is going to mimic God in an unholy Trinity. The devil, the Antichrist, and the religious leader. That's their unholy Trinity. But it is not new. All right? Revelation 9, verse 4. Revelation 9, verse 4. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. Wow. All right. If you notice what is going on here, the one chapter 7, verse 3 was telling, don't trouble the earth, death angel or whatever, destruction, destroyer angel, don't trouble the earth until I've sealed my 144,000 Jews in their foreheads. And then it is now saying, hurt the grass before you hurt the grass and whatever, and before you destroy, make some, you know, judgments there. Do not hurt the earth until they are sealed. And it says, only destroy or punish those who do not have the seal of God on them. So that's why I want you to understand that there's a whole heap of sealing going on, you know, a whole heap of marking going on, you know. So, yeah, and I don't know how many of this is resonating with for us to understand that in these days, the last days, the end time events that are going to take place, it is going to be the people of God are going to be identifiable and the people of the devil are going to be identifiable. It is going to be. And I know that for some of you, this is a little difficult or different to take in because, as I said, many of the movies I myself have watched, they have not portrayed it this way. They have portrayed it like a clandestine secret business when they try to put the movies together to say that this is going to be secretive and you don't know who the people of God are and you don't know who the people of the devil are. But if you just simply read the scripture, And just imagine it for a moment. You realize that, whoa, a lot of things are going to be well known. And it says here, there are going to be 144,000 Jews who are going to be sealed on their foreheads. All right? Chapter 14 and verse 1 says it this way. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 having his father's name written in their foreheads. All right. So now it is telling you what the seal is, the father's name. Now, again, I don't know which God has many names, you know, and quite a bit of Hebrew names. I don't know which one. But the idea is that now you're realizing that the seal of the 144,000 is not a logo. It is not like a cross, you know, because you remember you have logos, you know, you have symbols. You have cross and you have dove and so forth. It's not going to be of the 144. It is not going to be any symbol. It's going to be the name of God or a name of God. All right. And so, and I want to pay attention to this too when we look back at the mark of the beast. Because you, if you're realizing now, some of you, it's the bell supposed to start to ring, because verse 17, I'm jumping ahead just to bring it into context here. Verse 17 was telling you that they either going to take the mark or the name or the number. Interesting. It says here that the 144,000 Jews going to have the name of God etched on their foreheads. So the idea of a mark, a literal mark, is not far-fetched, nor is it hard to understand. Because all around, the people of God too will have a mark. But guess what? I'm not done yet. It is not just a holy remnant in Jerusalem that was marked. It is not just the 144,000 Jews that will be marked. Guess who else will be marked? Guess who else? We will be marked. Yes, all saints in our new bodies. There's coming a day that God is going to put a mark. And it is mentioned in Revelation 3 verse 12 and 22 verse 4. And if you don't believe me, look at the, open your Bible and look at it for yourself too. All right? Revelation 3 verse 12. Revelation 3 verse 12. It says here, him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. All right? Now, hold your horses before you even have a question and say, but Pastor, we're not going to tell you where. When you get to the last chapter of Revelation, they'll tell you where. But already it is telling you that one of the things that God is going to do to the saints, those who overcome, the saints of God, is that he's going to write upon them a new name. Now, let's not get into the debate of what that new name is, simply because, guys, he never said it. It is that new name is going to be a mystery. It is already a mystery. So nobody knows. So, you know, make no sense with debate and ask questions. What do I think it is? Nobody knows. He's keeping this one close to his chest. God is keeping this one close to his chest. All you need to know is that one day we're going to write on us a new name. We're going to mark us with a new name. All right? A name that nobody has ever heard before. A name that God has not used to us before. And so when you catch to Revelation 22 verse 4, you're going to see that this comes into play when we are at the end of days and living out our time in eternity. Revelation 22 verse 4 says, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. If you know the context very well, this is the end of time, meaning the beginning of eternity for us, happy eternal bliss. And it is talking about when we're on the new heaven and the new earth scenario. And it is saying that we're going to see his face, and we shall have the name in our foreheads. It is, and I tell you the truth. Sometimes we forget this. Sometimes, again, movies, pictures, you know, whatever you get from the internet. Sometimes when we have, you know, portrayals of how we will look in the, you know, end of days time in the eternal state, we forget about this, that we're going to brand it on the forehead. We forget about that. I guess some people choose not to put anything there because you don't know what the new name is. But we are going to have a mark too. So going back to this, the mark of the beast is not hard to understand, nor is it hard to accept that it is going to be a literal mark, because we will be marked too. All right. Any questions, any comments before we move on to, I think we'll be ready for verse 17. Any questions, any comments? Are you all with me? You guys with me so far?
Yes, sir.
All right. So far we're clear. All right. Any objections? All right. No objections. All right. So for anybody who is just joining us, we are clarifying the question. Is the mark of the beast a literal mark, or is it some kind of technological, you know, incision or whatever that is hidden? No, it is not going to be hidden. The people who choose to worship the Antichrist it is going to be a literal mark, simply because when you look on the other side of the coin, meaning when you look on the saints too, the evidence is also there that saints, holy men were marked in Jerusalem at one point, identification, who is for Christ, the 144,000 Jews will be marked, and all saints in our new bodies will be marked one day. So it's not hard to understand. So anybody who comes to you with, why, we think it's going to be some kind of technological thing. No, you just bring them to these verses and you realize that it is pretty clear. And the major premise of this is that it is for identification, to know who is on the Lord's side and who is on the devil's side. All right? All right. So, Revelation 13, verse 17. Let's really pay attention to this now, because it says here, and that no one might buy or sell except they have the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. No one might buy or sell except they have the mark or the name or the number of his name. Guys, before we dissect this, I said it on Sunday and I'll say it again here. Please understand what is happening here. When you go back to verse 16, even the Antichrist and the devil give choices. people who choose to have the mark or to take the mark are going to first of all have the choice of putting it on one of two places. So when you get to verse 17, the choices here only tell you and make you realize, oh, there are choices all around. Now, listen, let me make sure that nobody now misunderstand me. We're not saying taking the mark of the beast is good or right. I'm just telling you, though, that those who decide to take it will have choices. It is going to be either on their hand, and then the word that goes between is, or their foreheads, on their right hand, by the way, or their forehead. So is either one or the other. It never say right hand and forehead. It said right hand or forehead. So first of all, the placement of the mark of the beast is going to be a choice thing for people. They don't make the decision, and it's like hand, right hand, or forehead. I have a funny feeling that I don't think that there's any rule that some of them I don't think that there's any rule against some people. I have a funny feeling there are going to be some people who take both. You have some serious devil worshiper, you know. So also, I have a funny feeling that you're going to have some people going to take it from their right hand and then forehead. While you're going to have one set going to say forehead, please, another set going to say right hand. The idea is that there's a choice in verse 16. When you come to verse 17, there is also a choice. All right? You're going to either have the mark, it never say, and the name, and the number. It's one or the other, the mark or the name or the number. It's going to be a choice. Just wait for me, and I'm going to flesh out those three choices in a moment. But let's get this part out of the way. The mark of the beast relates to the buying and selling of food, conducting business, and possibly employment. You know, because if you cannot conduct your commerce, business, and so forth, if you don't take the mark of the beast, then obviously there are going to be people who are not going to have the employment if they refuse. And these people would have refused. Let me just put it this way. Anybody in my estimation who refused the mark would have chosen Jesus Christ. It's simple as that, because we know there's no middle ground. It's either they're going to be saved and they refuse the Antichrist and his mark, or they take the Antichrist mark and they're unsealed, right? So it's one or the other. So what is going to happen is that it is going to be difficult for the saints who trust Christ in those times. They're going to be in the minority, yes, but it's going to be difficult for them. They are going to have to find ways and means to survive, because they would have refused the mark, and they would not be able to go to Mega Mart. They would not be able to go to Progressive. They would not be able to go to Walmart. And all of those places, whatever is existing and will exist in that time, they will not be able to conduct business without taking the mark. And so those people who take the mark will flourish in that regard. So the Antichrist will claim jurisdiction over the traffic and trade of the world and make it tributary, meaning that he's going to make everything payable to him. He's going to benefit from it. So tributary to his own purposes. So all of the money, he's going to control the wealth. This is represented by saying that no one might buy or sell except by his permission. And it is clear that where this power exists, there will be absolute control over the wealth of the world. The Antichrist is going to be one powerfully wealthy man. All right? He's going to run the things. Or remember, I say money about a certain time. All right? He's going to run the world for a while. All right. So let's get into it. It says here that it's either they have the mark or the name or the number. All right. I was trying to explain to somebody on Sunday night about this too. And I told, you know, that you would get here in a moment. I want us to remember that the mark itself will still be visible. I don't want to confuse you. The mark itself is still going to be visible. But also, the mark has to be some kind of symbol. In other words, if somebody is going to tattoo you, the tattoo has to have some kind of symbol. You get me? You can't have a tattoo that doesn't have anything. You know, a tattoo that you can't see. So what I'm saying is that some people tattoo names of people on them. Some people tattoo numbers. Some people tattoo, even some Christians tattoo cross on them, symbol. That is what I was trying to explain to you, that what is going to happen when it says either the mark or the number or the name is that people are going to, again, have a choice here. All right? Something is going to be etched on their skin. The word mark here, as I had said to you before, and if you go back to the meaning and the study of the word, it also represents some kind of symbol. So let's say if you think that the mark, the tattoo or the etching is a slash, if it's a slash, then it's going to have to remain a slash for everybody. The mark of the beast is not going to be some haphazard like burning on them skin and another one burn. No, it has to be what I would call organized so that it's the same thing every time. So if it's a symbol, let me put it this way. We do not know what the symbol is. The pictures you're looking on are simply examples or possibilities. Some of you know these signs are signs of satanic worship and so forth, you know, devil worship, the goat head and the snake or the dragon. I strongly believe, but can't come to a conclusion on it either to say that this must be so. But you know that the devil definitely likes the symbol of a serpent since he came in the form of a serpent back in Genesis chapter 3. It could be possible that the mark, the logo itself will look like a serpent, or he's described like a dragon. He's described as a dragon in Revelation. So he could use any one of them. My point is this, whatever the devil is going to use to give to the Antichrist as the symbol or the logo, it is going to be constant. You're not gonna have goat head here, and dragon here, and serpent here. Remember, any company, think about those of you are business thinkers, any company that decides to have a brand, and I like that word, that decides to have a brand or a logo, it must be constant. You can't say you are Coca-Cola, and then you have 10 different logos. No, the logo is going to have to be constant in order to people to identify that this is Coca-Cola's brand. So it's the same thing with the mark of the beast. It's going to be one thing, whatever symbol he chooses is going to be that symbol. So anywhere you go, anywhere people go, and you see that on somebody's forehead or right hand, so for instance, he chooses a snake, you know that these people have given in to the mark of the beast. So get that for me. That then the mark is going to be some kind of logo, some kind of symbol, some kind of branding, all right? I don't want you guys to miss that. But it is a choice. That is going to be one of the choices. People do not have to choose the brand or the symbol. It says, or some people, it says, or the name. Now, I don't know what the name is either, guys. I don't know what the name is, so please don't ask me. Me just put up Lucifer there as just, you know, because we know Lucifer was, you know, the devil's name back in the day. All right? But we don't know what the name is. But remember, notice the R. It never said the mark and. All right? So if people don't want to be branded with a logo or a symbol, they may choose to be branded with the name of the Antichrist. All of them so far still represent the Antichrist. If the Antichrist chooses the logo of a snake, then that is what will represent him. If the Antichrist, of course, he will have a name, then that is what will identify him. But the logo will identify him as well as his name, of course, obviously. Now, there's something I want you guys to note, and you can question it, challenge it at this point if you want. Now, you know what? Let me finish this, and then I'll say that after. Or, so is either going to have the mark or the name or the number, which is 666, all right? Verse 18, we'll tell you that in a moment. So there are choices, and they can either put it on their right hand or on their foreheads, all right? This is actually the picture at the top of the man there. There's an actual picture of somebody who had already tattooed 666 on his forehead, interestingly. And there are satanic worshippers who have already decided to do this, you know. They just sold out to the devil. Now, some people start already, you know. But again, this is not full-fledged mark of the beast happening. It's just that some people already decide to sell their soul over to Satan. They want to be identified in that regard. So what I was about to say now before all of this is that if you want to challenge me, question it, feel free. I'd love you to do so if you disagree. The idea of either a mark or a name or a number is still going to be etched in. It is still going to be visible. So what I want you to understand about this is that there are going to be people going around who have accepted the mark of the beast with three different forms of identification. But they all represent the one thing. Again, this is what sometimes we never put together because we never just take the time to slow down and meditate on what the word has said. Because again, movies, pictures, you name it, would have just simply put out, and which is the most popular one, the 666. Movies, pictures, and so forth would have just made you think that people are going to go around with 666 on their foreheads or on their right hand only. No. Guys, it is pretty clear. It's one or the other. So you're going to have some that when choose 666 as their mark. You're going to have some that when choose, we're going to just use that example. Lucifer, a name, the Antichrist name as their mark. You're going to have some that will choose the symbol or the logo that represents the Antichrist as their mark. Either one will still be linked with the Antichrist. All right? Questions or comments on that? Disagreements, objections. What say you? Me sounding good so far? On awake or not asleep?
Yes, Pastor.
All right. All in agreement is there.
Okay.
And it sound logical. All right. Good. Again, the English language is very easy to understand. You know, it gives you the answer right there. If you never read it this way, just read the verse slowly. And I'll read it one more time for you. That no man might buy or sell except he that had the mark, or you're going to have the name of the beast or the number of his name. So interestingly, you know, they are linked, you know. Notice it says the number of the beast, the name of the beast or the number of his name. So again, in fact, I don't want to go ahead of myself. So let me reach to verse 18 now. And verse 18 is going to jump into what I'm about to say. Verse 18, I have it there, says, here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. Now, just for little participation, I want somebody who knows what you think this word means. When it says, let him that hath understanding count number of the beast, that word count, can anybody tell me what it is saying? Give me another word for count. When it says count the number of the beast, what does the word count you mean? Anybody knows? I'm certain somebody knows. Just unmute your mic. Nobody type. Just unmute your mic and tell me. What does count mean? What is he saying?
To calculate.
Very good. Very good. That sounds like Sister Carmen's Carmen Proud. Yes, that's what the word means. It means to count. To calculate the number of the beast. It can be calculated, you know. However, let me say this before we go any further. Guys, we have to be careful about this calculation thing, because I have to let you know that there are people's names that have calculated to 666. But what happened to them? Them dead and gone. And if you're following that history of that calculation, there were times when people have calculated, you know, certain popes and certain emperors of Rome and so forth, but them dead and gone. So what I'm saying is, be careful that you don't try to say, you know, because it's funny, you know, like people would have said, you'd have heard some people say Donald Trump was the Antichrist. See, what him done with that presidency, you know, you see? So be careful how you know, and some have said Obama too, but none of their names calculate to 666. So the first thing is that if you are trying to calculate who you think the Antichrist is, because he could very well be under radar right now. But if you find out, if you think you find his name, and you say, boy, Nikolai from Israel, or Nikolai from Russia, Nikolai Tchaikovsky, you have to calculate his name to find out if it adds up to 666. My point is this: if it does not add up to 666, rule that person out as a prospect for the Antichrist. Then remember that I'm saying two things. If some people's name add up to the 666, it does not mean that they're the Antichrist. I'm going to give you a quick joke here, right? And someone might have heard about this, and someone might not have heard about this. Do you know that? And I'm not, you know, make sure that I'm prefacing myself. Now. I'm just saying to prove my point that, and not everything that after 666 is the mark, is the Antichrist, sorry. Do you know that vaccination, the word vaccination, add up to 666 in calculation? I never said that there's anything wrong with the vaccination. I'm just saying, interestingly, and New York adds up to 666. So that's what I'm saying. Be careful that you know, say, oh, the person and him add up to 666 at the mark, at the beast, sorry, or at the Antichrist. No, because there are other things and names and places that add up to 666. But interestingly, as I was doing my study, I realized that vaccination add up to 666. Now, there are people who cannot handle an information like that. Them hear that now, and what them do? Them run it and say, see, let me tell you there's something wrong with the vaccination at the mark of the beast. No. So this is why the verse starts this way. I know I'm laboring it because I don't want us to miss what I'm saying. What do the first three words of the verse say? Here is wisdom. And then the verse says, let him that has understanding calculate it. In other words, this is not for common folk. This is not for the simple-minded. This is not something that you just take lightly and you just decide, say, oh, see the vaccination, 666. See the New York, we know New York, they've done a devil's city long time, sin city. You know, this is not for the unwise, because the unwise people are going to take the thing and run with it and put out all kind of posts to deceive simple-minded people. The idea is that, guys, use wisdom. I'm going to share at least two or three other translations for us to get what verse 18 is saying before we even get into this number thing one more time. The New King James Version says it this way: here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate, as Sister Prout rightfully says, calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666. The Revised Standard Version says it this way: this calls for wisdom, guys. If you're going to try to calculate putting people's name, it calls for wisdom. Let him who has understanding reckon the number of the beast, for it is a human number. Its number is 666. This one is the 20th century New Testament It says, here there is need for discernment. Let him who has the ability compute the number of the beast, for the number indicates a man's name. I like how the 20th century New Testament puts it. The number indicates a man's name. Its number is 666, guys. It's the number of a man. That's my last slide for today. It's the number of a man, guys. It is the number of a man. So what this is doing, and I'm going to stop sharing my screen now. What this is doing, guys, is that this is telling us that the Antichrist is going to be a man, first of all, and he's not going to be a woman. The Antichrist is not going to be an animal. The Antichrist is not going to be a machine. Guys, rule out everything that people are sometimes putting out there. Sometimes the Bible, and it's not everything in the Bible is hard. It's people that have put false theories out there that have made it difficult. The Antichrist is not going to be a system. He's going to implement a system, but the Antichrist is a person. He's going to be powerful. He's going to be empowered by the devil, yes, but he's going to still be a man. That is what verse 18 is trying to tell us. He says, guys, there's something big coming one day. And I'm only telling this for those who has an ear, those who have understanding, those who have wisdom. Listen, I'm giving you a clue. What we got was a clue as to who the Antichrist is. Now, the truth is, because the Antichrist may very well be under the radar right now, because I believe it is not meant for us to figure him out before the time. The issue is, though, that when the Antichrist does appear, unless the church is raptured and the Antichrist does appear, the people who will be living in that time, especially, I would say, the saints, the people who get saved in the tribulation period, they are going to have that knowledge and that wisdom. And say, let's say a world leader comes now. The church is raptured, new age and all kind of stuff going on in tribulation, and this new world leader comes. And this world, because you must remember, the Antichrist is going to cry peace, because the world was in chaos after the people of God are raptured, taken up. So this world leader is going to come and he's going to say, trust me, don't worry, I will put everything together. Anybody who is left behind and that is getting their way, making their way to salvation, so to speak, and, you know, not ready to take the mark of the beast yet, or if that is not yet implemented, they need to watch that world leader. And all they will need to do is to calculate his name. If you hear somebody start, so every world leader, and then when the Antichrist actually puts in his appearance, so to speak, and stamp his authority, and then people start to know who is, what is going to help to confirm it is just to simply calculate his name. His name with the number. And I've said this before to some of you who would have been in the Revelation study a few years back, that you can actually calculate, different names. There's a calculator you can Google. It's called the Mark of the Beast Calculator. And when you Google Mark of the Beast Calculator, it just tells you, put in the name, insert the name here. And it would just calculate it. So that's why I tell us that Donald Trump never add up to 666. Sorry. And others too. All right. So, you know, and again, Donald Trump down with the presidency. All right. So that is how people are going to, the work is already being done for you. And when you Google that Mark of the Beast calculator, you will also see that most of them actually do this. They give you a list of names and places that add up to 666. And so you will see some more examples there. But remember, if there are names there that add up to 666 and the people them dead, then man are the Antichrist because they're dead. So that's what I'm trying to tell you. There is wisdom, use understanding. But it is there though for when the Antichrist really comes into play. All you're going to know if you confirm, say, him is just plug in that and the people will know, say, the Antichrist. And then the rest is going to be history, because if you see a man start to say, follow me, and you must have a tattoo on your forehead or your right hand, you know, with my name, there ain't going to be no misunderstanding about it. So he is a mystery right now, and it is not for us to figure it out. My point is that when this unfolds, everybody will know. And God has a way of putting it in his scripture for people to figure it out when the time comes. Because, put it this way, even when things obvious, some people still not get it. So God give us a clue and give some people, but when the time comes, them can look back on this and say, oh, see all the signs here, right hand or forehead. Plug in the name, it is going to all add up, guys. And so understand the times and understand what will happen in the future. And may God give us wisdom and let us not try to do more or figure out more than what is given. We'll stop there for today, but I'll give way to any question or comment before we end. Any question or comment? You can just unmute your mic and ask or make a comment. Anything? All right. Nobody. Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much. We're going to close this segment with prayer, and then we're going to get into our prayer time, which you can give requests as we go along. So let's end this segment in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word, and I pray, dear God, that this will just simply enlighten us as to what's going on. This particular aspect of the series was for us to decipher what's going on now, because there are people who are bombarding us with different kind of information, saying this is the mark of the beast and that is the mark of the beast and vaccine is the mark of the beast and blah blah blah. Let us not be confused, let us not be deceived as well. If we read over Revelation chapter 13 with no one around and read it slowly, it is pretty clear what the mark is. It is pretty clear who will have the mark, meaning it is pretty clear who it will represent. So help us to not be confused anymore. These smoke screens that the devil, I believe, is using to just confuse people. Let us be wise. The last verse ended very well in saying that we need to be wise. If we have wisdom and understanding, we can discern. And we don't have to allow anybody to tell us any foolishness, because your word tells us what the mark of the beast is. So God, I pray that you will help us to be wise. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.